Welcome all. We all know about the atom is the basic unit of all the elements, as cell is the basic unit of our life. Hence, we are going to see the structure of atom, how it has been designed. Always a question arises in our mind that how and why has the atomic theory changed over time, and how can we describe the molecular motions of the state of the matter? Let's get answer to the questions. Matter is anything that takes up space and has mass. All matter is made of atoms. Atoms are the basic building blocks of matter. They make up everything around us, your desk, board, body. Everything that you find in your surrounding is made up of atoms. Atoms are too small to see without powerful microscopes. This is the basic atomic structure, which includes electron cloud and nucleus. The subatomic particles that are present in atom is proton, positively charged, neutron, zero charge, whereas electron, negatively charged. Now, how we have derived these, how we have discovered these subatomic particles, we will be knowing and discovering later on in this chapter, one by one. You can see the electron cloud, where electrons orbit the nucleus of an atom, whereas nucleus or or core of an atom is comprises of protons and neutrons. Charged particle present in matter. Atoms have three types of subatomic particles that we have already seen. They are electrons, protons, and neutrons. Electrons are negatively charged particles, whereas protons are positively charged particles, and neutrons have no charge. Therefore, electron is symbolized as E minus. Proton as P plus, as it is a positively charged proton, and neutrons as it not have any charge. Either we can write N0 or simply N. The mass of an electron, why the electron cloud we are able to see and it's not present in the center of the nucleus? The reason is the mass of an electron is 1 by 2000 times the mass of a hydrogen atom. So you can imagine the mass of electron is almost negligible. Whereas the mass of a proton is equal to the mass of a hydrogen atom and is taken as one unit. The mass of a neutron is equal to the mass of a hydrogen atom and is also taken as one unit. Hence, the mass of the nucleus of an atom is formed due to the presence of protons and neutrons. And that is the reason why protons and neutrons are placed in the nucleus of an atom. Discovery of the subatomic particles that we are going to see one by one. So first of all, let's see. In 1900, J.J. Thomson discovered the presence of the negatively charged particles called electrons in the atom by a cathode ray tube experiment. Whereas in 1886, E. Goldstein discovered a new radiation in gas discharge and called them canal rays, which helped them to discover a positively charged particle. These canal rays were termed as positively charged particles. This later led to the discovery of protons in the atom. In 1932, J. Chadwick discovered the presence of particles which do not have any charge in the atom, which is termed as neutrons. Hence, let's define the structure of an atom. According to Thomson's model of an atom, basically Thomson has compared the structure of an atom with a similar to Christmas pudding, and even it can be compared with the watermelon, as we have watermelon red color mass, whereas the brown color seeds are embedded into it. So according to Thomson, an atom is similar to a Christmas pudding. The pudding had positive charge and the electrons having negative charge, like plums on the pudding. Pudding means in Hindi that we call it as kheer, a sweet dish, kheer, right? Where the chawal and doodh is like your positive sphere, and your dry fruits that are embedded into it is like a negatively charged particles that are electrons. He proposed that an atom consists of a positively charged sphere and the electrons are embedded in it. I repeat, an atom consists of a positively charged sphere and the electrons are embedded in it. The negative and positive charges are equal in magnitude. So the atom as a whole is electrically neutral. Equal in magnitude means an atom is having same number of protons and same number of electrons. So protons are positively charged. For example, if an atom is having 10 protons, then that particular atom is also having 10 electrons, right? For example, if I take an example of helium, the atomic number of helium is 2. Then the number of atomic number determines the number of protons and electrons present in it. Hence, helium has 2 protons and 2 electrons. Therefore, atom is electrically neutral, which we say the negative and positive charges are equal in magnitude. So the atom as a whole is electrically neutral. Here you can see an example, that is the positive pudding, positive sphere in pudding, right? Or you can also compare this with a watermelon. This red color sphere is in your mass of the watermelon, whereas this blue color are the seeds of the watermelon. So this is what Thomson's atomic model looks like. Next came into existence about the Rutherford's model of an atom. Now, what did he do? He performed an alpha scattering practical experiment with the help of a gold foil, and he selected alpha particles. Now, what are alpha particles? Positively charged helium ion is known as alpha particles. Right, when helium ion, helium loses its electron, that is 2 electron is lost by helium. So it is remaining with 2 protons only. Therefore, that particular ion is termed as alpha particle. Hence, Rutherford followed, allowed a beam of fast moving alpha particles having positive charge to fall on a thin gold foil. And why Rutherford have taken a gold foil? Because as you have learned about the physical properties of metal, metals are highly malleable. Hence, gold is one of the metal which is highly malleable. That means which can be easily converted into thin sheets. And at that time, at that period of time, gold was least expensive, or we can say gold was very much cheaper. Hence, a gold experiment was performed. And you know, these gold is also least reactive. Hence, Rutherford allowed a beam of fast moving alpha particles having positive charge to fall on a thin gold foil. He observed that most of the alpha particles passed straight through the gold foil. Few alpha particles were slightly deflected by small angle, whereas few alpha particles were found or appeared to rebound. Now, why this might have taken place? As per Thomson's atomic model, the atom is completely having a positively charged sphere. So as per our study, the positive repels each other, whereas the opposite charge attracts each other as per the magnetic behavior. But here we can see when a positively charged particles were passed through the gold foil, so most of the alpha particles passed straight away through the gold foil. And very few got deflected, rather very few appeared to rebound. Hence, from this observation, Rutherford came into conclusion that is, most of the space inside an atom is empty because most of the alpha particles pass straight through the gold foil. The atom had a small nucleus having positive charge because some of the alpha particles having positive charge were slightly deflected by small angles. And the third one, the size of the nucleus is very small compared to the size of the atom. And that is the reason very few alpha particles appeared to rebound and most of the positive charge and mass of the atom is in the nucleus. So whatever observation he had observed three things, and for those three observations he came up with the conclusion. Hence Rutherford model of an atom says an atom has a positively charged nucleus at its center and most of the mass of the atom is in the nucleus. The electrons revolved around the nucleus in different orbits and the size of the nucleus is very small compared to the size of the atom. Yet, few defects were found in the Rutherford model of the atom, that is with respect to the arrangement of the electrons. Any particle in a circular orbit would undergo acceleration, and during acceleration, the charged particle would radiate energy. So the revolving electron would lose energy and fall into the nucleus, and the atom would be unstable. But we know as per Thomson's atomic model that is atoms are stable. Hence, this gets into the defects, or we can say the limitations, as well as we can call it disadvantage or demerit of Rutherford's model of the atom. Then to overcome his demerit, Bohr's model came up. Right, to explain the structure of an atom. He told an atom has a positively charged nucleus at its center and most of the mass of the atom is in the nucleus. The electrons revolved around the nucleus in spatial orbits called discrete orbits. These orbits are called shells or energy levels and are represented by the letters K, L, M, N. As per small n is equals to 1, 2, 3, 4, so on, where small n gives the number of shells, hence it is also termed as principal quantum number. While revolving in the discrete orbit, the electrons do not radiate energy and they do not fall into the nucleus of an atom. Hence, the stability of an atom was maintained. Let's see how the electrons were distributed as per Bohr's atomic model theory. The distribution of electrons in the different shells was suggested by Bohr and Bury. The following are the rules for filling electrons in the different shells. The maximum number of electrons in these shells is given by the formula 2n square, where n is the number of the shell 1, 2, 3 and so on. So let's find out how the electrons were calculated. That is, by putting n is equals to 1 in 2n square formula, we obtain that first shell maximum can contain 2 electrons, second shell can maximum contain 8 electrons, third shell 18 and fourth shell 32 and so on. The maximum number of electrons that can be filled in the outermost shell is only 8. This is applicable from the second shell onwards because first shell can accommodate only 2 electrons. Electrons cannot be filled in a shell unless the inner shells are filled. Hence, here we have listed first 18 elements, the shell-wise electronic configuration. For example, hydrogen atomic number is 1, hence it having first shell only 1 electron, whereas helium atomic number is 2, therefore first shell is again filled with your 2 electrons and the valence is 0. Then lithium having 3 electrons, so first shell completely filled with 2 electrons and yet it has one more electron, so that one more electron is filled in the second shell. Beryllium atomic number is 4, so first of all it will be filled in first shell, that is 2 electron, remaining is 4. And you can see so on, we can get into it, that is for example neon atomic number is 10, so 2 electrons in the first shell and the remaining 8 electrons will get into the second shell. And as we learned, that is a shell can maximum accommodate 8 electrons. So for sodium you can see as atomic number is 11, so first shell 2 electrons, second shell 8 electrons and then 1 electron, the remaining electrons. So on you can check the electronic configuration for first 18 elements. Similarly, if you check for 19th element, that is potassium, right? So 2, 8, 8, 1 it will be, and then calcium 2, 8, 8, 2 and so on. So this is how the atomic structure is been drawn. That is, in the center you can see this is the nucleus of an atom and you can see the electrons are revolving around the nucleus of an atom in a particular orbit. So we have listed your first 18 elements, the atomic structure of the first 18 elements. Now if it is asked, so you need to draw it in this manner. For electrons, either you can show small e with a negative charge or you can use a dot as well. Now atomic theory changed over time, that we have learned, that is first of all John Dalton's atomic theory, then J.J. Thomson, then Rutherford, right? So this is what the atomic theory has been changed after over the time period. And you can see which scientists have worked, that is the marble model, where John Dalton says that atom is indivisible. In 1803, John Dalton told that atom is indivisible. In 1904, Thomson has given, Thomson's atomic model was also known as plum pudding model, which says it has a positively charged sphere and electrons are embedded into it. Next came up with the nuclear model. Rutherford discovered the nucleus in the center of the atom. And then after, Bohr came up with the planetary model, saying that in the center of an atom, nucleus is present, which comprises of protons and neutrons, whereas electrons are revolving around the nucleus of an orbit in a definite energy level. And last but not the least, Schrodinger in 1926 came up with a 3D space, right, model, electron cloud model, where we do it with the, this is actually comes under the wave mechanics. So as we know, as we all know that we cannot see atoms, therefore we use models to teach and learn about atoms. And the atomic theory has changed over time as new technologies have become available. So this is what your atomic theory timeline, one more time to get yourself revised. That is, John Dalton has told that all matter is made up of atoms. Atoms are too small to see, indivisible and indestructible. All atoms of a given element are identical. Next comes J.J. Thomson. J.J. Thomson discovered the negative electron and predicted that there also must be a positive particle to hold the electrons in place. Ernest Rutherford discovered the nucleus of an atom and named the positive particles in the nucleus as protons, concluding that electrons are scattered in empty space around the nucleus. Now, James Chadwick discovered that neutrons were also located in the nucleus of an atom and that they contain no charge. That means they are neutral. Then after, to overcome the limitations of Rutherford's atomic theory or structure model, Niels Bohr came up with an experiment with a structure saying that electrons are located in planet-like orbits around the nucleus in certain energy levels. And many scientists, including comprises of the modern atomic theory, says electrons do not orbit the nucleus like planet, but move at high speeds in an electron cloud around the nucleus. That is the modern theory, which has also confirmed by the Schrodinger, Erwin Schrodinger. Next very important question, that is how we will find the combining capacity of an atom. We have already learned about the structure of an atom, that is the atom is further divisible into protons, neutrons and electrons. Next we will see how an atom can combine with another atom or element to give a rise into a vast number of compounds available in our surrounding. For that we need to know about valency. So what is valency? Valency is the combining capacity of an atom of an element. The electrons present in the outermost shell of an atom are called valence electrons. The electrons present in the outermost shell of an atom are called valence electrons. The number of electrons lost, gained, or shared by an atom to attain octet configuration is combining capacity or valency of the element. Right, if an element requires electron, it will gain. If an element do not require an electron, then it will lose. Hence, the valency of an element is determined with respect. This is what the table represent in front of you, is the periodic table of an element. And the positive one charging the valency of an element is plus one. Then it belongs to the group 1 element. If it is plus 2, it belongs to the group 2. Plus 3, group, it's not group 3, rather it belongs to group 13. Red is a modern periodic table, then it belongs to 13th group, 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th, and 18th group elements. As per the modern periodic classification of the elements, we know 18 groups are present in a periodic table. So this is how the sharing or as you can see over here, sodium atomic number is 11. Right, so its electronic configuration is 2, 8, 1. Now its valence shell is having only one electron. Right, and to attain the stable configuration or octet configuration, it requires 7 more electrons. Because as we discussed earlier, that the shell maximum can contain 8 electrons. Hence, to attain octet configuration to stability, what happens? Sodium loses one electron and it becomes, as it loses one electron, it gains a positive one charge. This we have already discussed in our previous chapter as well, that why, how an element receives a positive or a negative charge. So this is just a kind of revision while explaining again the valency, because we have already learned how a chemical formula can be formed with the valency, help of the valency. So here you can see that sodium is losing one electron, right? And it forms positive one charge, whereas chlorine is gaining one electron and forming a negatively one charged. And hence, when they form a molecule, it gets neutralized, which is having net zero charge. Similarly, you can check here about a covalent molecule, that is H2, right, chlorine atom. Here CH4 is forming water molecule. Then here is where you can see the formation of Ki is taking place. K, right, potassium having plus one valency, that means it loses one electron, and I is having minus one valency. Right, so it is gaining one electron. So the atomic number, of an element is the number of protons present in the nucleus of the atom of the element. Atomic number is symbolized as capital Z. All the atoms of an element have the same atomic number, right? Hydrogen is having 1, helium 2, lithium 3, and so on. Then what about the mass number? What is a mass number? So a mass number determines the mass of an atom. Now how we are going to calculate the mass of an element or an atom? That is with respect to the number of protons and neutrons, which is combinedly known as nucleons. Protons and neutrons are combinedly known as nucleons, which is present in the nucleus of an atom of the element. Hence, the mass of an atom is mainly the mass of protons and neutrons in the nucleus of the atom. For example, carbon, what is the atomic mass of carbon? We know it is 12. How 12? Because it contains 6 protons and 6 neutrons. And as we have discussed earlier, the number of protons will be equal to the number of the atomic number, as well as the number of electrons, whereas the number of neutrons varies from element to element. And hence the mass number will also vary, or else in few cases you can see the mass number is exactly double the atomic number, where the number of protons and neutrons are same. For example, carbon, right? The atomic number of carbon is 6 and the mass number of carbon is 12. Similarly, sulfur, atomic number of sulfur is 16 and mass number is 32, because they have same number of protons and neutrons in the nucleus of an atom. So depending upon the atomic number and mass number, we do have few isotopes existing in the nature. That is the different forms. So what are isotopes? Two or more elements with the same number of protons but different number of neutrons is known as isotope. That means we have carbon as an element which have its isotope. Hydrogen, we do have an isotope. Oxygen, we do have an isotopes. So there are, if you just get into the study of the elements, you will find so many elements are having isotopes, because isotope is defined as having same number of protons but different number of neutrons. or else we can define having same atomic number but different mass number is called an isotope. Next, we can talk about isobars. What are isobars? Atom of different elements with same atomic mass is called isobars. For example, argon and calcium. Argon having 18 atomic number, but atomic mass is 40. Whereas for chlorine as well, having 20 atomic number, but atomic mass is 40. So we can have isobars. Isobar means having same mass number, but different atomic number. If the atomic number changes, that means it will be a different element. So how isotopes and isobars differ from each other? Isotopes means atoms having same number of protons but different number of nucleons, whereas isobar means having same number of nucleons but having same number of nucleons means same number of nucleons but different number of protons. That is same mass number and different atomic number. Right, nucleons means having the number of protons and neutrons together is termed as nucleons. So this is all about your structure of an atom, which has a different theory as well as valency, isotopes and isobars. And based on this, you will have few numericals to solve.